And welcome to the Sarah Living Life YouTube channel. My name is Sarah, and I'm excited to have you here. This is a YouTube channel that is all about understanding what life with a disability can look like. So happy April. It is so beautiful outside. This is my favorite time of the year. I love being able to see all of the flowers to start blooming. I love hearing all of the birds chirping, all of those sort of sappy little things. It just feels like it's so alive that we're really waking up and finding all of this energy after sort of the harshness of the winter. So I really love that about the springtime, so yay. But also favorite things about April, it's my birthday month, and I absolutely take over the entire month as being my birthday month. I'm that person and that friend. Occupational therapy month, so it's sort of celebrating the profession of occupational therapy and spreading awareness as far as what occupational therapy is and how the occupational therapy specific profession and perspective is really helping to help arm people with the things and knowledge and skills and adaptations to be able to do the things they want to do and need to do, which is, you know, pretty fantastic. And it is also limb loss and limb difference awareness and pride month. I was talking with Nicole Kelly, you know that she's a good friend of mine, and we've had an episode with Nicole on the witches. Nicole and I work together on the Disarming Disability podcast, but we were chatting and we were just talking about, you know what, it should be pride month, in that we are really just talking about celebrating the pride of what it means to be somebody that has a limb difference. So I am absolutely proud and really happy to be in a space where I can say that I'm proud. And the fact that I am able to talk about this on a YouTube video and publish it for quote unquote like the world to see is something that I would have absolutely not have done maybe even like 3 years ago, that this is all within new year and new time and new research that I found and things that I've learned within myself to be able to be in a space where I'm just like, oh my God, I wish I knew these things earlier in my life. And here I am just trying to shout it in all of the different directions that I can, because it's absolutely exhausting to be ashamed of yourself. And for as long as I was ashamed of myself, it was just, what else could I have done with that time? But instead, I just was really shy and really scared. So, and with today's episode, I want to talk about three major vocabulary words that I found were pretty helpful in my ability to understand myself and my experience. So they're right here: ableism, internalized ableism, and microaggressions. These three sort of hang out together, and I find that they're just really great vocabulary words to be able to help articulate our experiences. So the first being ableism. Ableism is the one that speaks about the discrimination against people with disabilities or disabled people. And that is really looking at how there's a social constructs that we've developed where there's a preference to having a able body or a typically developing body. If we imagine what a person looks like, we are imagining them that they have, you know, two arms, two legs, they have all fingers and toes, they are expected to be able to conduct themselves in society in a specific way, and that is sort of what an able-bodied person looks like. The communities that we have designed have been in mind with a person of the able body. Ableism exists in that, like, I have an apartment that's on the third floor, which means I have two flights of stairs that I climb up, and that's something that didn't even cross my mind as being a barrier. However, stairs themselves are things that are pretty common into our communities, where those are pretty significant barriers for people to be able to live on their own independently. Ableism is really that terminology that helps describe preference for the able-bodied individual, and it is the, you know, discrimination against somebody who does not have an able-bodied. With that, internalized ableism is just something I found that was pretty fascinating. Internalized ableism is really that inward reflection that we as people with disabilities have the ableist view against ourselves. And that is that I don't think that I am able to do XYZ activity, so I'm not even gonna try because my body can't do it. More often than not, people who are disabled do not come from disabled families, right? Like myself, my parents did not have hand differences and my parents were not a part of the disabled community. So when I came along, they raised me in this sort of ableist world as expected because they raised me in the world that they knew, and I was disconnected from the disabled community and I didn't even consider myself a part of the disability community until maybe even, you know, 3 years ago, and that's when I found the connection through my occupational therapy program. But had it not been that, I would have probably still considered myself not part of it. But having that inward lens and judgment within myself, saying that I can't be a part of XYZ things because I don't have all 10 fingers, or that I am negatively viewing myself and the way that my body looks because I'm not able to fit up to the able-bodied social norms. That's sort of a little bit of what internalized ableism looks like. And it's really that like inward view where we put limitations on ourselves, you know, and it could even be things like, why would somebody want to date me because I'm this, you know, defective person, right? Like these are actual things that I thought, and I know that I'm not alone in thinking these things. I remember being terrified in high school of starting to date because it's like, why would somebody want to date me when they could date somebody with two full hands? And at that point, having a hand difference was a bad thing that I had believed. So my internalized ableism told me that I wasn't good enough to have a romantic partnership. Right? Terrible. Terrible. So I am thankful that I've really worked to bust that apart in myself, and I found a really great partner who's pretty fantastic. And I finally believe that I'm worthy enough to date somebody, right? And that somebody would want to date me. Duh. Like, and it's just mind blowing because these are things that are very real that a lot of us within these communities really feel and experience, and they're not good. So let's bust them apart. And then the last term that I would like to share today is a microaggression. And microaggressions can either be like subconscious, or they could be like people are consciously aware of them, but they're the actual actions and they're small. They can be small daily things that are happening. A microaggression can be something that someone says. It can be stares. It can be a specific look. It can be a judgment. So the fact that somebody needs to ask me what happened to my hand when I'm at the grocery store, that's a microaggression. And I may or may not experience harm or feel uncomfortable by it. So the fact that somebody's asking me that question, what happened to my hand, but isn't asking Eric that question when we're out at the grocery store, like that's a microaggression. A good friend of mine, Rachel Schley, was saying that when she was in elementary school, that she had expressed interest in wanting to play the violin, but then her music teacher saw her and said, that's not gonna work for you, and had given her a different instrument because the music teacher didn't think that she was going to be able to play the violin with a limb difference. So he made that adjustment and made that assumption. And the fact that he said, I don't think this is going to work for you, that is another example of a microaggression. So it's sort of like, what are these daily interactions that are said or experienced that really uphold or convey these ableist thought patterns? And I think that that's just a really helpful vocabulary word to have. So that really helped me deconstruct my experiences and really begin to find pride because I could separate out the negative things that I was experiencing. So instead of believing these bad things about myself, I could really be like, you know what? Filter, filter, filter. These are the things that are like not my fault. And yes, I make mistakes, and yes, I'm telling you I'm not perfect, I get that. This is able to separate out some of those experiences that were not my fault, but really looking at that these experiences happened because of ableism and microaggressions and internalized ableism, that then I was able to separate who I am and be able to come to spaces of pride so that when people say negative things to me, it doesn't hurt my self-esteem and it doesn't make me feel terrible about myself because I believe these bad patterns in my head. It really is when that happens, it's like, okay, well, That wasn't my favorite comment, but I know that that's a microaggression that's due to a person's ableistic thought patterns that isn't necessarily their fault either. It just really largely talks about this lack of awareness of the disability community. So with that, I'm happy that we went over ableism, internalized ableism, microaggressions, and hope that these are vocabulary words that can be really helpful for you in being able to articulate your experience. And let's be proud of the people that we are. Yay for sunshine and summer, and I'm excited to see you in 2 weeks. So like, share, subscribe, and I'll see you next time.